Hi, welcome everyone, and thank you all for attending Dechert's Nuts and Bolts webinar on custody rule considerations for advisors to loan funds and accounts. I'm Mike Sherman, a partner in the Financial Services Group, resident in our DC office and specializing in investment advisors matters. I'm joined by David Vaughan, who will introduce himself and kick things off.
Hi, this is David Vaughan. I'm a partner in the Financial Services Group, splitting my time between New York and Washington, and I also head up the private funds group here in the United States for the practice group. Today, we're talking about the custody rule and loan funds. We'll start out with a brief overview of the custody rule, just a refresher for those of you familiar with it and kind of background for anyone else, since the guidance that comes out deals with some of the technical requirements of the rule. The rule has been interpreted many times with respect to different elements of custody that can have a particular impact on loan fund managers and managers of other sort of non-traditional assets. You know, most things or many things that trade outside of the traditional sort of equity markets on exchange. So Mike, I turn it over to you to describe the custody rule in general.
Sure. So, as I'm sure you all know, the custody rule is not the the model of regulatory clarity, and it has some difficult application cases. But at base, it's a fairly simple concept of covering situations where an advisor either holds client funds or securities or has authority or ability to obtain possession of them. And the definition is fleshed out through three examples of situations where an advisor could be deemed to have custody. The first is actual possession, and then with an exception for inadvertent receipt, with prompt return 3 business days by the rule, and then extended in some cases based on guidance given to the Investment Advisor Association. The second is a situation of power of attorney under which the advisor is authorized or permitted to withdraw client funds or securities upon instruction to the custodian. So this is the authority to obtain possession or access. And then the third is the situation where the advisor has legal ownership of the client funds or securities through a trust or a limited liability company or limited partnership where the advisor or its supervised persons have authority through that position to deal in the client's assets. And then the custody rule also imputes custody where an advisor's related person has these sorts of authorities. And it just as a refresher for this purpose, a related person means any person who's directly or indirectly in a control relationship with the advisor, so controlling, controlled by, under common control with. So it's a fairly broad definition, and it picks up more circumstances than what one would think of in the colloquial sense of having custody or acting as a custodian. It's also non-binary. In other words, just because one party or person has custody doesn't mean that another party or person might not also have custody. An advisor who is deemed to have custody is subject to certain requirements under the rule, and in general, the requirements are the qualified custodian requirement, so maintaining the assets with a bank, a broker-dealer, an FCM, or another financial institution that commonly provides custodial services. In a separate account under that client's name, or in accounts that only contain client funds and securities, but where the advisor is the named account owner and is acting as agent or trustee. And so this will come up in importance later as we talk about the agent account situation and the guidance issued to Madison. But the essence here is that client assets and other assets cannot be commingled in a custody account. To the extent the advisor opens the account on the client's behalf, they have to notify the client of the custody arrangement, and they also have to provide cautionary language to the client to check the statements that the advisor may send about the account with the custody statements from the custodian. so that the client can be aware if there are discrepancies. The advisor must conduct due inquiry to have a reasonable basis to believe that the custodian sends account statements on a quarterly basis to clients. And the advisor must, in many cases, undergo a surprise examination at least annually by an independent public accountant. And as we'll discuss later, there are some exceptions to each of these, but these are the general rules of the road for having custody. Advisors that have custody must maintain certain policies and procedures reflecting their custodial practices, must make disclosures on Form ADV, notably Item 9 of Part 1 and Item 15 of Part 2A, and they must maintain books and records related to their custodial practices and accounts. And to the extent the advisor acts as a qualified custodian, in other words, is the real, air quotes, custodian holding the assets, the bank, the broker-dealer, and where the bank or broker-dealer custodian is a related person of the advisor, there's a requirement to obtain from the qualified custodian an internal control report describing the custodial practices. And in that case, the accountant that prepares the internal control report must be registered with and subject to regular inspection by the PCAOB.
Yeah, Mike, just to jump in on we're going to get to pooled investment vehicles in a moment where there's an exception, but if you did try to comply with the basic rules, as I would say here, you have to note that the qualified custodian has to send the account statement directly to the client. If it's a fund and you don't fit one of the exceptions, you actually have to have the account statement that is sent to the investor in the fund has to be of the fund's investments. So the portfolio of the fund, not the person's ownership in the fund, has to be sent to them. And in my experience, there aren't many qualified custodians who are set up to send out account statements to, you know, more than a handful of people on one account.
Yeah, and what's worse, it also would include cash flows in and out of the fund, so it would reveal to each investor who the other investors are and how much money they're putting in or taking out. So obviously that's not a desirable situation. And fortunately, the SEC provided some exceptions. In the pooled vehicle context, there's something called the audit method, whereby the fund undergoes an annual gap audit generally for some offshore funds. Alternative accounting procedures can be used with a reconciliation to GAAP for U.S. persons, and that gets distributed within 120 days for your garden variety fund, and then longer period of time for a fund of funds or a fund of funds, so that they can rely on the underlying fund accounting statements in preparing theirs. And if an advisor does that for the partnership, the account statement, client notice, and surprise examination requirements fall away. Additionally, certain types of securities don't need to be held with a qualified custodian, mainly because they're typically not. So shares of mutual funds are typically held through a transfer agent for the fund, and that transfer agent can serve in lieu of the qualified custodian. Similarly, certain privately offered securities, uncertificated, that are, you know, transferable only through the issuer or the issuer's representative can be held directly by the advisor, or more to the point, don't need to be held by a qualified custodian. But to rely on that for a fund, the audit method must be employed. There are also a couple of other circumstances where a surprise examination can be avoided. One is for fee deductions. So if an advisor has authority to make withdrawals to pay an advisory fee, and that's the only basis for custody, that doesn't require a surprise exam. And similarly, if custody is through a related person that's a distant relative and operationally independent, which is a pretty high standard, that also doesn't require a surprise audit. There have been some staff regulatory guidance as well that carves certain things away from the surprise examination, like standing letters of authorization and the like, but that's kind of outside the scope of today's discussion. So, David, I think I'll turn it over to you for the first pain point in the discussion. David?
going to talk about delivery versus payment and its implications for whether someone is considered to have custody under the custody rule. So one of the things that I've found with, you know, clients over the years is that many clients, when they hear the word custody, just say, well, I don't hold any securities for my clients, and therefore I don't have to worry about that. Most people, I would hazard to say, who are deemed to have custody and subject to the custody rule aren't actually holding the securities. They are just able to withdraw cash or securities from the account, and that is the basis for them to be considered to have custody. So the question really is, if you're trading in an account, right, where you have discretionary authority, money's coming in and out of account all the time, along with the securities, so that you can actually trade. And I think the intent of the rule was that if all you're doing is exercising discretionary authority, the normal course trading, that that wouldn't be considered custody. Otherwise, the rule would simply apply effectively to all advisors that have discretion and be, you know, potentially overly broad. So when the rule was adopted or revised substantially, the release basically said, as long as it's authorized trading, that gives you access to client accounts, but does not give you the kind of ability to withdraw cash or securities that would implicate compliance with the custody rule, because after all, you're simply exercising discretionary authority. So many people view that as being a logical result. The thing is, a lot of things trade in accounts where they might not be, strictly speaking, delivery versus payment, where a security goes in, the corresponding cash goes out, or vice versa, simultaneously. And a lot of things don't trade on a DVP basis. And so the question was, you know, does that somehow implicate that person as having custody? Well, in 2017, the Investment Management Division came out with an interpretation about inadvertent custody that talked about different situations they had become aware of where people were questioning whether they had custody or not, and decided to issue an interpretation of that. And basically said, if you're not trading delivery versus payment, then you may well have custody and have to comply with the rule. So what exactly is delivery versus payment? Well, it's sort of what it sounds like. It's when the cash or securities go in or out of the account at the same time. And so if you get the account statement right, you can see the cash coming in, cash going out, securities corresponding to that coming in or out of the account. Many things don't sell DVP. Bank loans, other loans, which we're talking about today, whether bank loans or not, typically do not. Derivatives don't, right, because they're not coming in and out of a traditional brokerage account. You have lots of different privately placed securities and the like, which would not be settling on a DVP basis, as well as, you know, mortgage-backed securities, forward settlements, et cetera, that don't settle that way. Variation margin, for example, on a swap would come out of the account, but traditionally, you know, a swap wouldn't be held in the account, so you wouldn't have that DVP type arrangement. So we go to the, Mike, maybe you talk a little bit more specifically about what that guidance was in 2017 and how it implicated the custody rule status of so many advisors. Mike?
The reminder to unmute my phone. So the IM guidance focused principally on situations where there's authority in an ancillary document to the advisory agreement, such as a custody agreement, that provides a greater authority to the advisor than the advisor expected, and that alone was surprising, that an agreement to which the advisor was not a party and often was not privy could create custody. But then to top it off, they also indicated the view that a trade that's not DVP creates custody, I think based on a footnote inclusion of what, you know, a litigator would describe as dicta in the 2003 release, saying that generally custodians are under the instruction to settle things DVP, which provides some protection against the ability to misappropriate assets. I'd always viewed, prior to the IM guidance, the authorized trading concept in the 2003 release as, you know, a bargain that was made between protecting clients from situations where misappropriation was, you know, possible, likely, and a danger, and avoiding imposing undue burden on ordinary discretionary management, such that the management that that was anticipated based on the advisory contract disclosures and relationships would not yield custody, but authorities beyond that, check writing authority, for example, would. And I think I was surprised. I know I was surprised. I think lots of people were surprised by the aspect of the IM guidance and the way that they sort of twisted the use of the phrase in the footnote about DVP to create a whole new class of people that are all of a sudden in the staff's eyes deemed to have custody. And it's interesting, we point out on the slide, hopefully it's legible on your screen, it's kind of small on mine, that the language or transfer in the staff's language in the guidance was not in the rule, was not in the release. It was, you know, withdraw, not transfer. And so that was sort of piques the eye. And so the upshot being that non-DVP instruments and advisors trading in them are all of a sudden in scope for custody, and OC began to make comments on examination about this aspect and start to ask advisors what to do about it. And, of course, immediately the industry reacted fairly immediately anyway within a year. There were letters submitted, although certainly discussions had begun with industry participants, the trades, and the staff about the concern that we all had with the expansion. So SIFMA, AMG, and IAA notably submitted letters to IM and OC addressing concerns, and we understand that the LSTA also made a no-action request around loans on this. And they were basically seeking a more practical approach so that the business and very important business that loan managers do for the economy, not just for their advisory clients, but for the borrowers could continue without interference from the custody rule. And so the concern was raised that this major change is something that many advisors would now be brought under the fold, that advisors didn't really have sufficient warning against this, that there was not a huge level of risk regarding this, and that the statement of the SEC in the adopting release surrounding what we're calling the authorized trading exception was a statement of the SEC that went through notice and comment rulemaking, and that the IM guidance was not, and that any change of this sort should be subject to the Administrative Procedures Act. I saw a question come in about the status of bank loans, and the question is essentially whether bank loans count as funds or securities under the custody rule, which is a difficult interpretive question. A bank loan typically, or a loan in general, often is not going to be viewed as a security under the 33 or 34 Act. However, the staff historically has taken a position that the definition of security, although substantially identical to those other two statutes under the Advisors Act and the 1940 Act, the Company Act, is not equivalent. And the staff has taken the view that a loan can be a security under the Advisors Act or under the 1940 Act, without being a security under the 33 or 34 Act. And generally we advise for planning purposes that advisors view these as securities, and hence the concern under the rule. So there's been some further guidance out of the SEC staff on the 2017 IM guidance, but it didn't address this issue. It addressed issues around when an advisor should be charged with custody based on knowledge or imputed knowledge of the custodial agreement and the terms thereof. And this has been silent. At one point, it was thought that the staff was close to issuing guidance to the LSTA about loans, but that apparently has been held up, and instead the custody rule has been placed on what's called the long-term regulatory agenda, which I guess in bureaucratic speak means we're going to get to it sometime, for industry comment and perhaps a proposal of an interpretation or a rule amendment that may solve this issue, or, to be fair, might make it worse. We further understand that the staff has been thinking about this, and that OC has forestalled making comments on these situations as a general matter while it's under consideration. So we're not seeing on examination significant emphasis on non-DVP arrangements. So I think that's probably the background that's most relevant for this group. And David, maybe you can talk a little bit about loan managers generally as we slide towards the Madison letter.
Thanks, Mike. Yeah, I'm happy to do that. One thing that someone asked about, which is a little different than what we're focused on in the Madison letter, which is on the movement of cash and payment of loans and interest, is how one custodies the loans themselves, right? So the custody rule requires that securities, and again, you can argue the point, but as a practical matter, I think most people will treat the loans as securities for planning purposes, while not necessarily conceding that. So how do you hold a loan like in a custody account? The exceptions from having to have a qualified custodian for privately placed securities don't fit loans very well typically, because they require either not be certificated and non-transferable. There's some guidance that certificated securities that are really not transferable without consent don't have to be with a qualified custodian. But the loan market, typically, you don't need the consent of the borrower or the other holders of the loan when it's been participated out, for example, to transfer the loan. And so that would be a big difference in the terms of a loan and also reduce its liquidity and therefore pricing, presumably. What people tend to do based on some SEC guidance is have document custody for the loans, right? So they open an account and the loan documents go into that account. Now, in today's world, of course, those are often electronic or usually electronic as opposed to paper documents, but they're nonetheless held by a qualified custodian in a document custody account, which one can debate how much value that really adds to the clients as far as safety and security, but it does check the box with the SEC as far as being able to say that you've got the loans properly custodied. Cash, of course, is a lot simpler. It's going to be in a bank or broker-dealer as a practical matter to move through the system, but the loan documents are a little more difficult. Many lenders finance loans that they originate, funding a portion of themselves, but also either syndicated out to third parties or have advisory affiliates or themselves that use them as assets to purchase for advisory clients. Now, this might be somebody who's a non-bank originator or has a bank affiliate that's originating the loans and then has an advisory affiliate that is otherwise managing assets for clients, including in those loans, because those loans are something people want to have access to. As described in the Madison No Action letter, originators will often hold a portion on their own balance sheets, right, because they're out there originating loans for their own account as well as for third parties and for clients. They then syndicate a portion of the loan to third parties and potentially private accounts or private funds that they or, more typically an affiliate, manage. The lender then, or an affiliate, typically administers the loan, works as an administrative agent to service the loan. And that means they're authorized to act on behalf of the lenders, but also effectively collect payments, so through an agency account. And you can imagine that if you're a borrower and your loan has been syndicated, you probably don't even know who owns your loan at that point. You need a single point of reference to pay your interest and principal, and then you need somebody to parcel it out to whoever the current holders are, and that typically will be an affiliate of the originator or, you know, someone in that position. In that account is a conduit for all of the cash going out to the lender if they're having a drawdown of some kind on a loan or establishing it in the first place, paid interest payments, other payments coming in of principal and the like, and there's a single point of contact for that, and that is the way the loan market works in practice. So in addition to having this more sort of traditional type of basis for custody, right, that money that's coming into and out of that administrative agent account, at some point, you know, you can debate this, but at some point it may well be seen as belonging to the client, right? So the cash principal's been paid in, a portion of that's due to an affiliated advisor's client of the administrative agent, and if you view that as the client's money at that point, then at that point the affiliate has custody and you're subject to the custody rule. And typically that is how things flow. And prior to the Madison letter, there was a lot of question about exactly how to deal with these administrative accounts because they don't work well within the traditional custody arrangements because, you know, they're commingling assets of clients and non-clients because you've got both the third-party buyers of the loans plus the affiliates of the loans, not just the clients advancing the loans. And it's all flowing through one account, which even if properly titled, you know, doesn't really fit within the requirements of the rule. So when they're administered by an affiliate, it gives you this effectively custody, at least in theory, over that client account, and then that account is subject to the custody rule, which, as we've talked about, requires a qualified custodian. That's usually the easy part. Qualified custodian includes any bank. Where else are you going to hold cash, right? So that's not a big deal. That's more how the account is titled, and this fact that the rule says the account should only hold client assets, and it can be commingled, but only with other clients when held, you know, in an agent account for the benefit of the client. And so you also have the account statement delivery requirement, where in theory you would be delivering to each of those clients or each of the investors in a private fund, unless you have the audit, the account statement for that agent account. Now, if you think of that agent account, I don't think if you're coming to it from the outside as an investor or a client, you could really make heads or tails of all the cash flows because there's going to be, you know, many of these agents will only have one account because they just use that for everyone because that's administratively what makes sense. And therefore, the money coming in and out of that account would include loans in which that client has no interest and also be voluminous in the amount of transactions that go through it. And as a practical matter, custodians are not typically set up to deliver 150 account statements on the same account. That's not what they're typically in the business of doing, and there's a lot of confidential information going there that you would not be appropriate to show to everyone who might be in, you know, the syndicate of one loan out of 100 that's being serviced through that account. So then we move on to the Madison Capital No Action Letter, which is our first glimpse of how the SEC staff is viewing these issues.
For a number of years, the industry and frankly us and I think our peers were a bit perplexed about how to deal with this, you know, and we tried various approaches to get close enough without, you know, impacting unduly the business of lending and agenting and, you know, making sure that borrowers could borrow and so on. And we took some degree of comfort in the idea that the SEC was unlikely to shut down such an important industry. But we knew sort of in the back of our minds that there was these two disconnects, the account commingling issue and the quarterly statements issue, to the extent there were participating clients that were not funds using the audit method. And then finally, in December of 2018, basically right before the lights got turned off for a month and a half at the SEC, a letter came out to Madison Capital that allowed advisory clients to participate in senior loans syndicated and administered by Madison, with assets flowing back and forth through an agency account in a manner that is consistent with the custody rule, with the guidance laid upon it, by giving relief from those two provisions. And again, just to be clear, from the provision that requires that the account be maintained either only in the client's name. And so if you did that, you would be in a situation of having a separate agent account, essentially, for each client, right? Each client that participates in the loan. And so the borrower would be in the position of writing X number of different checks, which would, I think, not make you very popular with borrowers. Or it accounts for all of the borrower clients, but no other participants in the account, which would, you know, maybe reduce the number of checks the borrower would write, but not down to one, which still would make you unpopular. And then the quarterly account statement requirement, if you apply that, remember David talked about how that worked in a fund, where it was the fund's account statement, and it showed all of the assets of the fund and all of the cash flows in and out of the fund. Well, this would be all of the cash flows in and out of that agent account. And so assuming that, like many, you have a single agent account for all or substantially all of the loans, this would expose information about borrowers that clients were not involved in and information about other clients to each client that had a stake, for lack of a better word, in the agent account. And it also would result in the provision of account statements that were inscrutable to a client. They wouldn't understand all the flows, inflows and outflows, and be able to make use of the account statement delivery, which is intended to allow a client to recognize when there might be something untoward going on with their assets because there's a cash flow out of an account, for example, to an entity or a person that doesn't appear to be related to the management of the account. And so Madison went in for the relief. Our understanding is that they had this issue flagged on an OC examination, and that OC suggested that Madison talk to IM about this. I think OC recognized that there was an issue, but you know, OC's job is to sort of look at what the rules are and see if they're being applied correctly, and they couldn't sort of process the disconnect. And so over time, as these things work, relief was negotiated and conditions were imposed that the requestor and you know, by proxy, the industry hopefully can live with, and that the SEC staff viewed as reasonably protective of the client's interest. And so we kind of broke these out into a few general conditions and then a couple of particularly meaningful conditions that we'll discuss in more detail. The general conditions are as follows. The agency account has to be maintained at a qualified custodian, and I think as a practical matter, it will be maintained at a bank. And the assets in the account will be assets related to the loan syndicate and the loan participation, right? So it's not, it won't be the advisor's own assets, it won't be other assets that are unrelated to the lending activity. The deposits will come into the account and withdrawals will come out of the account only pursuant to the documents that govern the loan and the loan syndication. So the agent will be behaving consistent with the expectations of the participation, the syndicate participants with the, you know, the borrower in funneling money to and from the borrower. The agent receives payments from this account only in its capacity as agent. And this allows the the payments and the assets of that account to not be subject to the administrative agent's bankruptcy. We do understand, however, that the agent can take its agency fees out of the account and any other fees that are due someone based on the lending activity can come out of the agent account without violating this condition. And finally, at least among the general conditions, there's a disclosure requirement that's expected that the client asset custody is disclosed as it would always be in item 9 of Form ADV Part 1A. And our understanding is that this would include a snapshot of the assets that are in the agency account as of the date that you use as the reckoning date for your Part 1 filing. So that might be zero to the extent that the agent account is often devoid of assets as they flow through and are cleared, but it could be that there's a payment that sits in the account at the end of the day on the day that you count your custodial assets. And then the description of the agent account and the fact that there's custody involved in it would be put in item 15 of Part 2A, where advisors are required to describe their custody arrangements and to disclose to clients certain information about them. Madison had obviously time to negotiate these with the staff to discuss them, and they included in their incoming letter sort of a form of disclosure, which is, in my view, overly lengthy and potentially overly detailed. And I believe that an advisor can take its own view and counsel as to the level of detail necessary to satisfy this condition. It doesn't need to be the full page plus of disclosures that Madison intends to provide. And so with that, I'll turn it over to David to discuss the more particularized conditions that are the ones that I think got the staff comfortable issuing the Madison guidance.
Okay, thanks, Mike. Just before I turn to that, let me answer just a couple of questions that people have been putting through that I think will help people follow the conversation. So the Madison letter really deals with where the administrator for the loan is affiliated with the advisor or the advisor itself, right? So you have that affiliated person or what they call related person custody issue. If the loan administrator is not affiliated with the advisor, so it's a third party, that issue, you know, for the advisor or the third party administrators isn't so much the Madison issues that we're talking about, but you can still have that DVP problem that the SEC has pointed out, because the cash typically will be held in a bank account, but when you buy the loan, you and other people pointed this out too, you really can't put the loan into the same account. It doesn't really get held in a bank account in the same way that an equity security could be held in a brokerage account. So it's not coming back. It may be coming into a document custody account, but it's not going to be coming back into the same account the cash went out of. And so if you, even with a third-party administrator, you still have to deal with the SEC's issues on the DVP in the loan market as well. So one of the major conditions that is part of the Madison letter, and I think in some sense is kind of the heart of it, is this idea that you have to have, or the agent must have, control objectives signed up so that they can make sure that the agent's process is appropriate for handling and safeguarding from both loss and misappropriation, the cash that's coming in and out of that agent account, that they're distributed in an accurate manner and completely, and everyone's getting the money they're supposed to, and that the actions are being taken in accordance with the terms of the loans, that the payments are being made appropriately, interest is getting paid when it's supposed to, all of those good things. That would be an important part of the no action letter, but it is also probably the most costly part, because you have to engage with an accounting firm to both, you know, help design this control environment, which as a business matter, most people already will have a control environment, right? You'd be typical that if you're handling that much money for people, even though you're not necessarily a regulated entity, it would be normal business practice to have a control environment. But now it's got to be agreed with an accounting firm, and checked. And so it does become a bit more onerous. I think it's important to note that the internal control report we're talking about is not necessarily the same kind of control report you would get if you had an actual affiliated qualified custodian acting as a qualified custodian. Those control accounts are really quite costly and extensive because they look at the entire control environment of the custodian. Here, you have the option of doing a more limited control report policies and procedures that are really just focused on the functions of that one account or that account and the processes around it. You'll need to get an attestation on the internal control report from a regulated accountant. So, of course, this goes back to the problem people sometimes had where you've got to have them registered and subject to regular inspection by the PCAOB. So it's important to note that. They'll have to do an opinion on whether the controls have been established appropriately, and then they have to verify that they've been operated within them. And if it's they have to verify the assets to an unaffiliated custodian. So where you've got, you know, a third-party bank as your actual custodian, presumably that's not too difficult. If you're using an affiliated bank custodian for the cash, that could be a little more problematic. You have to maintain that opinion. And
David, I've done some thought on this because I'm aware of at least some folks who use an affiliated bank for the agent account. And to the extent that there's a qualified custodian for the client accounts or client, you know, pooled investment vehicles to which the flows from the agent account would you know, come from, it may be possible to get comfortable with that reconciliation as reconciliation to an unaffiliated custodian, provided that you know, client level custodian is in fact unaffiliated.
Right. So going on with the conditions, so you have to quickly resolve or promptly resolve any exceptions to your control report, which makes sense. The one condition I think people find more troubling is that you actually have to notify any affected advisory client of any issues with a qualified opinion and describe how you're going to resolve those going forward. And that is something where, you know, one would hope that you wouldn't get a qualified opinion or you'd get some chance to remediate, but, you know, you could see situations where it would be material to a client what the control failures were, but you could also see situations where it might not be and it might be disclosure that the client would either find confusing or not really be necessary in the sense of materiality to them. So
I had an opportunity to discuss how an auditor might view this. And one of the things that they charitably offered was to do what they called readiness exercise before the first control attestation. And for the, you know, what I'm sure would be a reasonable price, or not particularly reasonable, they would walk through their expectations on how to get a clean opinion so that the advisor can be confident that their first opinion will be clean, assuming that they're acting in accordance with the protocol set forth.
Right. Okay. Mike, maybe we can go to you on further thoughts on the letter.
Sure. And obviously, David, you should chime in. And we've had some time to think about this. We've had conversations with various folks about it. And our thoughts are kind of, you know, this is good in the sense of now we understand one way to comply with the custody rule and we understand what the staff's thoughts and expectations are. It's not clear yet that this is the only way. And in fact, the staff invited the industry to come back with alternate approaches or to ask other questions. And I've had discussions with Aaron Gilbride, who wrote the letter, about you know, other things that, that might be relevant or appropriate and that, that, you know, maybe we'll turn into to additional guidance. But in a lot of cases, we think that the things that are expected here are things that, that agents already do. Like they already have a control environment for making sure they do their job correctly. Maybe they don't call it a control environment, but they have one. And, you know, auditors are gearing up to be able to do the attestations, and advisors already generally hold these. In fact, I'm unaware of any situation where an agency account is held somewhere other than a bank. So much of the letter should be reasonably easy to comply with. One thing that was not clear on its face, but I think clear in its omission from the letter, is that there's no relief from the surprise examination requirement. And the letter was very, very clear about this encompassing accounts that aren't pooled investment vehicles relying on the audit method. And if you look at Madison's ADV, you'll find that they, in fact, only have pools that are subject to the audit method. But that the, so I surmise the staff asked for that, that language to be included so that the letter would be more, more broadly applicable. And so, you know, that, that, that means that the surprise examination requirement would apply to the extent that the audit method doesn't cover it off for all clients. And we think that the scope of the surprise examination would be just the agent account, not other assets of those clients. There's still open questions, of course. It's unclear exactly how this applies if the agent bank that, that's holding the agent account is an affiliate, although we think we have an idea of how that works. And also, it's unclear about situations where the affiliated agent is a remote affiliate that is operationally independent and whether the staff would entertain relief geared to that circumstance. And I did ask Aaron specifically about that, and he indicated to me that he would think about it and get back to me. So hopefully at some point we'll have an answer there or an invitation to seek guidance. One other note that I think is worth mentioning is that the letter makes clear what I think we all kind of understood in our guts, that, that having an affiliated agent with authority to direct cash flows through an agency account to clients, to borrowers, to third parties, to the advisor or its affiliates would constitute custody. It also makes clear that use of an agent, an affiliate agent, is not a definitive circumstance where there is or isn't custody, but rather that, that advisors should analyze whether the authority that they have over an unaffiliated agent meets the definition of custody. So the extent that the advisor could order the agent to prosecute a cash movement in the same way that they might order a custodian to effectuate a cash movement in another context, that could constitute custody, either of the advertent or inadvertent variety. So advisors who are in these arrangements but don't have an affiliated agent are still not off the hook to do at least a little bit of thought as to what control, if any, they have over the agent that acts as such for the loans that their clients hold. So that's, David, those are kind of my thoughts. I don't know if you had any others or if there were still outstanding questions that we can address in the last few minutes.
Yeah, we do have a number of questions, and maybe I'll try to address a couple of those. Apologize, we probably won't be able to get to all of them. And one question was, whether there's any guidance when you hold the documents for the loans, you know, exactly which documents you're supposed to be holding, and can, whether there's guidance confirming that the electronic holding of documents is sufficient. I think there's not really any specific guidance in this space, in the fund space. They've talked about subscription agreements and the like. I think with the fund documents, you know, it's typically you know, the loan agreement, and if there's a note, certainly the note would be part of it, but sort of the basically the documents embodying the loan are what's stored. And I think it, at this point, it's clear that, you know, with proper controls, electronic holding is acceptable. I can't remember the release off the top of my head, but there's been a number of them over the years that have dealt with those issues on electronic holding of documents. Another question about whether, if you're trying to use the account statement method in the fund context, whether you could use the fund custodian to send it, or sorry, the fund administrator to send it, and have the custodian only send it to one person. There is in the rule the ability to have an independent representative that's sufficiently independent of the advisor to receive documents on behalf of investors. I think people have found that a little cumbersome, but in theory, that something like that could be feasible if you're driven to using the account statement method. I think the audit method is by a large margin the most popular way, since most investors in a private fund are going to want an audit in any event. So it's kind of a dual purpose document.
There was a question about whether Madison could be relied on if the agent account only has the assets of a single client in it. I think on its face, absolutely. The question I would ask is whether it needs to be. If there's only the assets of one client, no other assets, no advisor assets, et cetera, then you don't have the commingling problem. If that client is a fund and it's audited, you don't have the account statement problem. And you don't have the surprise exam issue either, so you may not need to rely on Madison. If you do have either of those issues, you might want to rely on Madison, but you might also consider whether simply doing the account statement delivery would be appropriate in the circumstance where you have a single client having the entire sort of participation in the agent account.
Now, one more question I just wanted to address here before we wrap up was the question of whether with Madison, whether that control report would have been required if they had instead transferred the administrative functions to a third-party administrator, so an unaffiliated one, not Madison, not one of its affiliates, but a completely unrelated entity. And yes, while you still have custody issues with loans because they're not DVP, the control report element is a condition of that no action letter, which is specific to having the affiliated administrative agent. And so if you had an unaffiliated one, you know, assuming you don't have other control over it, if it's truly, you know, you probably avoid custody altogether, again, looking at the circumstances over that account. And so you wouldn't have to deal with the control report, which is a condition to relying on the relief here if you have the advisor or an affiliate of the advisor is the loan administrator.
There's one more that I think is worth noting. The you know, no action letters are generally based on their facts, although I noted the deviation from actual facts and letter facts that I discovered when I went and looked at Madison's ADV. In Madison, it was the fact that the advisor also acted as the loan administrator. But that's not always the case. Sometimes an affiliate acts as the administrator, and we believe, and I think it's been borne out by the discussions I've had with others, that should not preclude reliance on the letter. If it's whether it's the advisor itself or the affiliate acting as agent, you should equally be able to rely on the letter.
Yeah. Okay. Apologize to the questions we didn't get to, but I want to thank everyone for attending today, and I hope it was informative.